Now, unless there are any further questions, I'm ready to start talking about the content of the course. That's okay? Yeah.
There are no exams then, or are there only two papers?
No exams. Two roughly 8-page papers. And anybody who feels that they really know so much about it that they want to write a 15-page paper at the end, that's okay too. But you really need to know something about it, because otherwise you need feedback in the middle, knowing whether you are writing what counts as a sensible paper, since nothing you've had before prepares you quite for knowing how Heidegger's going to deal with this and how you're supposed to deal with him. The model you've got is me, how I'm going to try to deal with it, and Liz and Forrest, they're all going to show you, I hope, how to make sense of and defend and criticize the kind of new way of looking at things that late Heidegger's got.
You should probably clear it with somebody if you're going to write.
Oh, absolutely. You have to clear it with whoever your TA is, or if you're a graduate student, with me. Graduate students in general will just write for the TAs, except for graduate students in philosophy who will write papers with me. Any graduate students in philosophy? There usually aren't. Oh, really? Oh, yeah. That's right. You would be taking it. Good. Well, you're writing with me. And you. Okay. Then, so we will talk about that, and you will write 15-page papers, presumably, though you don't have to. Okay. I'm ready to, yeah.
I came in late. I don't know if anyone brought this up, but on the web it says the room is 308 McCon.
That's right. Next time.
Next time.
Yeah. But the web, that's very scary. I wonder if that means that people are over there already in 308 Lacombe. There are?
I think they got the message and they're going to wander.
How'd they get the message?
Oh, that no one showed up.
So they're going to come here?
Either here or 2060.
Yeah, that's the trouble with instant technology. I carefully didn't put it on my door and didn't hand this out, but I forgot that, of course, the website, they will... But how did they know where the website was? They went to my homepage. Anyway, this will teach them to be so technologically advanced. Okay, onward. So, the first question is, why study Heidegger? And it's probably obvious to everybody that we should study Heidegger because he's the most important and influential philosopher in the 20th century. And all the important continental philosophers... in the 20th century are indebted to a large extent to Heidegger. It sort of divides up into two groups. The early Heidegger people, that is Being and Time, written in 1927, is the big influence on Sartre and Merleau-Ponty. They would not have been able to write their big books and carry on their sort of debate within existentialism and without all coming spinning out of Being in Time. And then Heidegger went through a kind of change, in German, a Kehre, that is what he calls it, a kind of turnaround, and that turnaround produces late Heidegger, and that happens around somewhere between 1930 and 1933. There's a whole industry for dating the Kehre and trying to figure out just what it is. But one thing is sure, by the time he's writing The Origin of the Work of Art, he's doing something entirely different than he was doing in Being in Time. I'll explain that before the end of the time. But the people, late Heidegger influences all these familiar figures to you, or some of them are familiar to you. Derrida couldn't have done what he did without Heidegger. Foucault, on his deathbed in his last interview, says that he owes everything to Heidegger. Bourdieu, who's too clever to admit it in print, told me that his first love in philosophy was Heidegger. Habermas was a thorough Heideggerian until 1957 when he discovered Heidegger's politics and turned against Heidegger, but Habermas comes out of Heidegger. So anybody important in continental philosophy is some kind of Heideggerian and some kind of anti-Heideggerian, because they're all defining their position in opposition to something or other Heidegger said. That's one reason for studying Heidegger, that you couldn't understand anything in continental philosophy if you didn't. The other thing is, it's very important for understanding who we are, what our culture has got itself into now, and what kind of human beings we are now. one of late Heidegger's big jobs that we'll be paying attention to is to try to figure out what are the essential features of modernity, and it has something to do with being a subject, being autonomous, and technology, and the possibility of scientific research. He comes at it from lots of different angles, and but he's always asking, sort of, what are the essential features of modernity? We will see that most when we read the. Do we read it? Well, let me see. Not in this course. Okay, yes, we do. I thought I lost my mind. Okay, when we read the Age of the World Picture, which is the clearest attempt to define modernity. By the way, I'm going to try to read this book, Basic Questions of Philosophy, because I read it and I thought it was extremely interesting, and it might be very illuminating and fun to teach, to see Heidegger going back and trying to explain what philosophy is, starting with the very beginning in the pre-Socratics. We'll see. That's the only book on the list that I don't know well already and know where it's going, but that'll be fun to find out. So what he's trying to do is find out what modernity is and then tell us what's wrong with it, find a position from which to criticize it, which is tricky because he can't say, well, the essence of human beings is such and such and modernity doesn't fit it, but he's got to have some view about what human beings are, or else he can't say there's anything wrong with modernity, because that would be just another way human beings could understand themselves. So he's got to get a position, and he does have, from which to criticize it. And then he has weird, interesting suggestions of how to get beyond modernity. Modernity equals the Enlightenment, by the way, equals what gets started with Descartes and how we came to think of ourselves as subjects dealing with a world of objects. Lots of other things too. But in any case, his three big proposals for how to get into another understanding is to think about things in terms of art, and that's in the origin of the work of art, to think about it in terms of things, and we're going to read the essays on things, and to think about it in terms of language. Those are all three ways out of the modern understanding of who we are. And what's important is it's not hard to find an alternative to the modern understanding of who we are. That's called postmodern, and everybody's got some version of that. And Heidegger thinks that starts with Nietzsche, which I guess most people think. But Heidegger thinks that the Nietzschean postmodernism is nihilism, is even worse than modernity, or maybe worse. I mean, it's worse and therefore better, because it shows more how unlivable modernity really was all along. And so Heidegger wants some alternative to modernity, to the Enlightenment, which is going to not be nihilistic. And we're going to have to find out a lot about what that means and how he tries to do it and whether it works or not. Now, that was just very general background about sort of why you might want to take the course. Now, unless there's anybody got any comments about that? I mean, this isn't the sort of thing I expect you to have comments about. Well, if you do, that's fine.
If you really have no background in philosophy at all, are you, like myself, am I going to be able to handle this course, or is it really...
Probably not, no. I'm afraid. What year are you in? What field?
Junior, and I'm a business major.
And you've never had a philosophy course?
Yeah, I have, but it's been a while.
You better come and talk to me, but I suspect there is so much taken for granted philosophy jargon and ways of thinking and posing problems that it won't work for you.
Okay.
I'm assuming, as I say on the syllabus, that you've had some advanced philosophy course, whether it was Nietzsche or Heidegger or Foucault. What did I say? I made a list as best I could. Or Hegel. Those are the courses that would prepare you for this. And if you haven't had any of those, then I don't think... You're welcome to audit, but I don't think you should take it. Okay, now I'm going to talk about being in time, for the rest of the time, maybe, and try to tell you what it's... Not all the things it's about, but the part of it that's going to be relevant for this course. I'll tell you right off, the part of it that's not relevant for this course is what I think of as the existentialist part. Authenticity, death, guilt, what all is that comes in what in division two of being in time. I'm only going to talk about division one of being in time, because it's out of division one that the problems of late Heidegger come. He just drops the questions, of the existentialist questions. He gives them to Sartre to worry about, and has his own different questions. So what's really important in being in time for Heidegger is the notion of world for later Heidegger. Now, so I have to try to explain what he means by world. And always when you're thinking about Heidegger, you've got to have some phenomenon in mind, because he does. And he's capable of being extremely abstract, but he's always got his feet on the ground too, thinking about hammering or cabinet making or parties, the mood at parties, or how students feel when they're staring at the blackboard and so forth. So one side of Heidegger's got some phenomenon, the other side has got some very abstract way of dealing with it. He's sort of half peasant and half high-powered academic. So when you think of worlds, start by thinking of our ordinary notion that there's the theater world, the business world, and us, we're in the academic world, and we want to know what in the world that is. So what are the common structural features of these worlds and of all sorts of other worlds that we are familiar with? Well, Heidegger thinks that there are three basic features of any world. There's equipment for that world, business equipment and theater equipment and blackboards and stuff that we have equipment, and there is that with that equipment, and all that equipment is interconnected, so that in the academic world, you've got to have a combination of professors and teaching assistants and librarians and students and deans and lights and blackboards and chalk and notebooks and all this together. You can't have just one piece of equipment for being in the academic world. So there's a totality of equipment, and we have, if you're in that world, to be in that world, you've got to have skills for dealing with that equipment. And that's the first thing. Then there's, and for his example is, he talks about hammers and how hammers are tied up with nails and with frames and with houses and so forth. Then you need to have, there have to be goals in that world. I mean, you have to use the equipment in the order to do something. So you use hammers in order to drive in nails and build bookcases and build frames and build houses and so forth. And you have goals in the theater, and you have goals in business, and you can figure out what they would be. And goals in the academic world you know well, like passing exams and then graduating and then so forth. And then the third thing is, besides equipment, besides goals, you need identities or roles that people can take on. They are interpretations of what it is to be them. So just to take my case, I take on the role professor. I interpret myself, I am a professor, that's my identity. And it's for the sake of, in Heidegger language, being a professor, that I have goals like teach the course, read the books, explain things, grade papers, and then for that I use the equipment. So at the sort of highest level, there are in a world the ultimate roles or identities. In Heidegger language, you could say the stand that people take on themselves. My stand on myself is being a professor. You're right now being students. And then on the basis of that, the goals, and then to satisfy the goals, the equipment. That is all goes together to make up, that's all organized into one totality, and that is the world. There's all these really sub-worlds I've been talking about. The theater world is a sub-world, and the academic world, and the business world, and the world of politics, and they're all part of this world, which is some broader bunch of equipment with a big range of roles and goals and skills. And Heidegger's interested in none of these sub-worlds. He's not even interested in the big world. He's interested in what he calls the worldhood of the world, which is the structure of any world. And I just gave you the worldhood of the world in one, in its in a simple version, when I told you about the equipment, the goals, and the identities. Now, what do you get when you've got a world? Then it really, that's when it really gets interesting. What you get is that in terms of a world, which is now our skills and practices for dealing with things and dealing with ourselves, that's what enables us to, in Heidegger language, encounter anything as anything. So in terms of my skills for using equipment, I can encounter this as equipment for holding up my paper and so forth. And you are encountering your pens and so forth as for writing down lectures and so forth. So entities show up as something or other in this in a world. And so one way they can show up is as equipment. And then they have a way of being, which Heidegger calls available.
For the challenge.
Yeah. I can't do it. Okay, I'll write it here. Okay, that's the equipment. Or we also have skills for just staring at things and noticing their properties. Or even more, measuring their properties. We're able to do science, but we're also able to just enjoy sunsets. Those aren't equipment in order to do something and achieve some goal. And we're capable of doing that too, which we could just say, perception. So we have this ability to perceive things. They are occurring. Now, Heidegger, when you've read Being and Time, this was called Ready to Hand. I have my own way to translate them, but if I don't tell you the other way, you're going to get very confused. And this is Present at Hand. And we have skills for dealing with ourselves. This is done, right, Forrest? I can erase this. And we have skills for dealing with ourselves, which is something like this business of taking a stand on ourselves. Stand on who we are. And that way of being, this is Heidegger calls the Dasein. Dasein is a way of being whose being is an issue for him, he says. That's us. Dasein is people. So what it turns out then that the way we our general practices for dealing with things and for dealing with ourselves enables us to encounter three kinds of being. Being available, being a current, and being there, which is literal translation of Dasein. And another way to put this is, it makes everything intelligible to us, that we make sense of things as equipment, we make sense of things as, I'm tempted to write objects or things here, but I can't write either really, because those are sort of technical terms for Heidegger. That's equipment, what am I going to call this? Let's call it stuff. It's a new development. Okay, so I can make sense of equipment, I can make sense of stuff that I stare at and measure, I can make sense of myself. They become intelligible insofar as there is a world, insofar as, another way to put it, I have practices for dealing with things and finding them familiar in various ways. And all of, so now it turns out that world is what makes things intelligible to us, that is, remember, makes things make sense to us as equipment, as stuff, as me or other people. So that finally, world is what gives us what Heidegger calls an understanding of being. That's just another way of saying makes things intelligible. So it gives us an understanding of the being of equipment, which is just being available, the being of stuff, being of current, the being of Dasein, all of that is made possible by this systematic organization of equipment, practices, and goals and roles. So, in Being and Time, Heidegger defines being as that on the basis of which beings are already understood. That is what I've just called the intelligibility in, you can now add another word for the Searle people, the background practices, or the Wittgenstein people. The background practices are these skills for coping with things and people and so forth. On the basis of these skills, then things show up for us in various ways. And it's on the basis of that that stuff is, he wants to say, already understood, meaning that if you didn't already have skills for dealing with equipment, you couldn't make sense of things as equipment. If you didn't already have the ability to perceive and notice the properties of stuff, you couldn't make sense of the stuff. If you didn't have the capacity to take a stand on the kind of being you are and have an identity, then you couldn't make sense of who you were. So in the background is always this, you can now say in the background is the world, or in the background is the understanding of being. They come very close to being the same. To being the same thing. And another way to put it, there is, and maybe this is the common root of them as far as I can see, an understanding or an ability to cope with things that's in the background of all of our skills and all of our practices. Now that's all you need to know, I think, about being in time to go on from here into late Heidegger. It's going to turn out, and I'll say more about it, that, but maybe I should say it right now for once. World is going to be something very hard to study. It's going to be invisible because it is so, for three reasons, really. It's so pervasive that we can't, well, think of it this way. No, if I say it too soon. No, sorry. If I didn't write it down now, there was a reason. If I try to explain it now, I'll have to explain something else and everything will get confused. I'll get there. The main thing now is just to conclude that in Being and Time, Heidegger thought that he had told us the structure of the world in a lot more detail than I told you, and mapped the structure of the world onto the structure of time. That's why it's called Being and Time, which you don't need to know. But the important thing is that he thought that he had found the cross-cultural, ahistorical structure of worlds, any old world. The world in Bali, it's still got equipment, it's still got roles, it's still got goals. The world of the ancient Homeric Greeks, no matter where, whatever world you please, Heidegger has given you a description of its structure and what it enables you to do. Namely, let objects show up as something and make sense of the various ways of being. That's as far as early Heidegger got. And then Heidegger discovered something quite amazing, that there isn't just one general structure of world, but that worlds are very different. Different cultures have different understandings of being. There, and our culture has had several different understandings of being in the course of its history. What could that be like? Well, Heidegger has a distinction. I didn't write it down here, but it might be useful to have it. These are understandings of being. I'm not going to use that term anymore for this next day. This is early Heidegger. Understandings of being. That's how he talks about it. And there is only one, there's only one, the understanding. That's what he's looking at. Later, he's going to say, there's a plurality of, and now we need another place to put this, the truth of being. It's not that there's really any important difference in whether he calls it truth or understanding. I don't see any difference. But you need another word, because the way this is set up, there's only one of them. And now he's discovered something else, which we haven't explained yet, of which there's a lot of different ones. So let's call those truths of being. It's a lot less natural or understandable to call it truth of being than to call it understanding of being. And maybe at first, for the first 20 years, I just thought of this as lots of understandings of being, but it's better probably to stick to his terminology. So, what are these different truths of being? Well, you could say, and it turns out to be a very helpful thing to say, different cultures have different styles. Different styles of dealing with stuff and dealing with equipment and dealing with themselves. Clifford Geertz, who's a famous anthropologist, has a sentence which sort of fits this idea. And he calls it an ethos. He says, a people's ethos is the tone, character, and quality of their life, its style. And that's why I think it's a natural thing to come across, to talk that way. And you can say that the practices are not only, this is my terminology, not only organized into a world, but then there's a higher level of organization that organizes them into a particular style. Just for jargon, I want to say, here, this is how the practices are organized. And over here, we need some other word. Let's say these are how the practices are coordinated once they're organized. So, to take an example, driving practices are all organized by having to drive on the right or having to drive on the left, and the equipment and the turning signals and all of that. And that's enough to give you the world of driving. But it's easy to see that driving also comes in different styles. That the way the practices are coordinated in New York, where the people drive with an aggressive style, is very different than the way driving practices are coordinated in California, where in general people are extremely polite. And if you drive like I do, having learned in Boston, sort of making U-turns in the middle of turning around completely in the middle of the street if you see a parking place on the other side, and so forth. People are stunned. Unless they also learn to drive in New York or Boston or Paris or someplace where you do whatever you need to do to win, whatever you want to win. So, but if you have a different, and you can change the organization, you can have, whether you drive on the right or whether you drive on the left, it doesn't make any difference. That's just the way the practices are organized, different in England than here. But here it makes a big difference, how you change the style. That's why people from California have accidents in Paris or Milan or New York. I mean, and notice that in these two different styles, different sort of things show up. What shows up for a taxi driver in New York is a chance to get ahead of everybody else before the next stoplight, and what looks maybe to us like a gap in the traffic looks to them like an opportunity to pull in ahead of somebody and win a one round and so forth. That's aggressive driving. And what will show up for people are opportunities to obey the law, to be polite and let other people go in front of them if they're trying to pull out of a side street and so forth. Different possibilities will show up. And another phrase I haven't used, different things will make sense to do. It'll make sense to rush to the next light and step on your brakes just because you got there getting there first and being able to pull out first in New York. And here it makes sense to drive at the speed limit and get to the next light when it's changing and so forth. Though that's just a simple example. I'm going to give you a much more complicated example now. But there's a third thing. The style determines what shows up as anything, but it gives it new filling. I mean, it already showed up as equipment or stuff, or Dasein, but now it shows up as you'll see various sorts of opportunities. I'll fill in the as a lot more as we talk. The style determines what it makes sense to do. And another whole thing which I haven't talked about, which is extremely important, what's worthy or unworthy. So an aggressive style shows you that it's worthy to win and unworthy to be a wimp and let everybody get in front of you. And a polite, sort of nurturing, laid-back style shows you that it's worthy to obey the law and to facilitate the traffic and to help people who are lost and so forth. This business of what's worthy and unworthy, which Kierkegaard calls qualitative distinctions, is going to be very relevant to nihilism. I mean, nihilism is a situation in which the distinction between the worthy and the unworthy disappears. And but that will be getting way ahead of the story. So now I'm going to give you, and those of you who had me in Heidegger in being in time, I think I said this already, and I certainly do it in my commentary. A while back somewhere, I discovered what strikes me as a beautiful example of two different styles and how these different styles enable different things to show up and different ways of behaving to make sense. And it's done with little babies. And that's important because what you want to be clear about, and I haven't said this yet, but I'm saying it now, is the style of the culture isn't in people's beliefs. It's not a belief system. It's not the rules they follow either. It's not in the jargon of the business. It's not represented in their minds at all. It's something that they get socialized into so early that it's in their bodies and in the discriminations that they make. And that's very important to Heidegger. That's one way to get out of the subject-object way of thinking, out of what, say, you'll hear if you take Searle's Philosophy of Mind course, which I strongly recommend, just because it's exactly the view that Heidegger is trying to destroy. namely, that we are subjects with mental representations and things appear to us as something because we have certain, what Searle would call propositional representations in our mind. For Heidegger, it's something much more a pre-linguistic, pre-propositional, and embodied that we have when we take over the style of a culture. So let me give you my example. It turns out that sociologists studying Japanese and American child rearing have generally come to the view. Now, by the way, it doesn't matter at all whether this is right or not. You can think of it as a Martian thought experiment. We shouldn't get into a discussion of whether this is Western sociologists misunderstanding Japanese child rearing and so forth. We can imagine two cultures. One of them you can think of as an aggressive culture, that's us, and one of them as a nurturing culture. That's this other culture, and supposedly the Japanese, and in which in the nurturing culture, the mothers are trying to encourage their children to be calm, and they're soothing them, and they're singing to them. And in the other culture, the mothers are trying to get their children to be as active and vocal as possible. One of my TAs early on when I discovered this said that, and who was married to a Japanese woman, said that it, and I don't know whether this is true, but it's certainly interesting, that American mothers tend to put their babies in their cribs on their stomach so they'll crawl around, and Japanese mothers tend to put their babies in their cribs on their back so that they lie happily looking at the things that are waving around over their heads. In any case, we supposedly get babies in the one case that are full of gesturing and vocalization, and the other case, babies that are more contented and ready to sort of enjoy just being there. So, and in general, then, the mothers promote these two styles. One promotes, again, passivity, sensitivity to harmony in the actions and in the surroundings. And, of course, the babies take up these two styles without having to have any thoughts in their minds at all because they're already doing it when they're tiny, tiny babies. And at one point I was worried about the question, but how do the babies know which gestures to pick up and to get the style? How do they pick that up so early? How do they notice what's important? Well, the answer is what is really interesting. Everything that the mothers do in that culture embodies the style of the culture that they were socialized into. They don't know they've got it, but they gesture with it, the tone of voice they have, the distance they stand from the child, how they pick the child up, how they pick the child, put the child down, is all in the style of either aggressive or nurturing. So the babies couldn't miss it. And they will, and since babies are just little imitation machines, as far as I can tell, having seen them at close range, they will just pick it up, and they will start having Dasein in them because they will start having a stand on what it is to be a human being, which they will take up with as they get socialized. What constitutes an American baby is a certain pervasive style of behavior, and what constitutes a Japanese baby is a different pervasive style of behavior. And once you've got the style, it perpetuates itself, because what will make what will show up as interesting and what will make sense will be different for the two styles, and they and will reinforce them in whichever direction they're going. So you can imagine now, just to finish this, that it will affect too sort of how things show up. And this is now beyond any sociologist and probably beyond any fact, but you could imagine the Japanese, though let's take the American baby, we know them better, like rattles. They like to make a lot of noise with the rattles and then throw the rattles so the parents have to go chase them and bring them back. And I can imagine that I hope it may be even true. I know the Japanese babies would like to listen to the noise of rattles the way these rain sticks work that the Indians have that make this nice noise with the seeds in them are very soothing. You could use a rattle to be soothed by the sound of it. And that would be, let's hope, the way it would work. Yeah, that would rattle would show up as a different sort of thing. And when you got older, then different sorts of objects would look attractive to you. So for the American baby, let us suppose, grows up thinking that that things are there to satisfy their desires and then get out of the way once they've satisfied their desires. So for cups, a styrofoam cup would be just great. It keeps the tea hot if you're drinking tea or coffee, and when it's hot, and it keeps it cool when it's cool, and when you finish it, you just throw it away. That's a really terrific kind of object to have for us. But the Japanese would, if the story is right, prefer a teacup, which would be delicate and traditional and come down in the family, and around which you could have a tea ceremony, and it wouldn't keep the tea very hot very long, and it would be a lot of bother to keep clean. You couldn't just throw it away, and it would be, you know, delicate and easy to break, but it would still be the best kind of object. So things, because they would have the kind of skills and the kind of sensibility that would go with that. And so, of course, also for what it makes sense to do. When they grow up, then it looks like the Americans would want to be striving, willful, satisfying their individual desires, and the Japanese would want to be integrated, socially harmonious with their fellow human beings and so forth. And that would in turn reflect in the kinds of politics and business in the Japanese, supposedly in their business, aim at cohesion, loyalty, and in politics at consensus. And of course, American business is aggressive, laissez-faire. Everybody wants to get as much as they can and express their own desires. And in politics too, we think that politics amounts to everybody expressing their desires and then maximizing the number of desires that can be satisfied without creating destructive instabilities in the process. So what have we got? We've got the claim then that here are two different styles, two different truths of being, and in them different kinds of things show up, different ways of behaving make sense, and different things are worthy and unworthy. And that's what I wanted you to see. I have to make a footnote. Heidegger thinks, and we'll come back to this, that in fact, we're the only culture that has a unified understanding of being. I've been pretending as if the Japanese culture does, and I don't really have any clear evidence that they don't, but Heidegger would, I think, well, I do. It's the polytheism of them. I mean, we've got one God and one understanding. I think the Japanese have a lot of different gods and different local understandings. And maybe there's one overall understanding, but I don't know. But Heidegger claims that it's a peculiar fact about our culture that started in the 5th century BC that we got one unified understanding of being. You can think of, for instance, lots of cultures that didn't. My brother's wife is an Egyptologist, and she, just to show you what it would be like not to have a unified understanding of being, she said the Egyptians, the ancient Egyptians, had something like 12 different creation myths. They were all contradictory with each other, And they had no problem with that. Different ones were evoked on different occasions. There was a myth for harvest time, and a myth for men, and a myth for women, and so forth. And the idea that there had to be one coherent story about how the universe got created just didn't occur to them, didn't bother them. But starting with the pre-Socratics in the 5th century, in our culture, people started wondering what it was that everything had in common just insofar as it was. What was the general feature of everything? And then, and once you've got that, Heidegger thinks, you will get a whole series of different total understandings of everything. And one way to see that other cultures don't have total understandings is they don't have what Heidegger calls history. Of course, they have a lot of events, a whole bunch of dynasties in Egypt, one after another, and they kept track of them. But for Heidegger, history is changing truths of being. And in our culture, we certainly have had a bunch of them. He only mentions three in The Origin of the Work of Art. By the time he gets really far along, he thinks there have been seven of them. I'll tell you the three. I mean, it's obvious that there was something like the Greek world, the Christian world, and the modern world. And they had completely different understandings of being, or truths of being, different styles. Roughly, Heidegger thinks, and we'll hear more about the Greek world in when we read the Basic Questions book, that they had a sense of being, that everything welled up and lingered for a while and then went away. Dick Rorty talks about how everything was whooshing up for the pre-Socratics. You can, I mean, certainly if you read Homer, the gods whoosh up and suddenly there was Athena and there she was for a while and then pop, she was gone again. And heroes whooshed up. Everybody, I mean, Ajax was perfectly normal for quite a while and then one day he went around and killed thousands of people. He went completely berserk and he was a superhero and then he went back to being normal again. This is the way things looked to the Greeks, apparently. And so people showed up as heroes or slaves, and things showed up as sort of wonderful and sort of flashing out at you. And then the Christian world was very, very different. There were creatures. Everything was created by God. Things were full of meaning. People could only be, they couldn't be heroes. I mean, they couldn't be heroes and villains or heroes and slaves anymore. You could only be saints or sinners. That's how people showed up. And, of course, you couldn't have been a saint or sinner in Homeric Greece. There was no place for that. I mean, if you turned the other cheek, that just meant that you were a hopeless loser, the slavish type that let everybody walk all over you. And you couldn't be a Homeric hero in Christian times because they were self-sufficient and proud and protected other people and people sang songs of them as if they were the best in the world. That would be pride to take yourself to be that sort of hero and be glad about it. You'd be in the bottom of the inferno for that sort of thing. So it's a different world, and the modern world is different again. We're now subjects, and that means, among other things, that we think of ourselves, oh sorry, we could put in for the Christians, it was all a question of desires. Saints had pure desires and sinners had bad desires. This is a Foucault point, that Christianity defined us in terms of our desires. For the Greeks, it was in terms of our actions. And what the modern one is, you get defined in terms of your autonomy. How much you are lucid about this. A modern subject, according to Kant, who defined it best, is supposed to be lucid about the rules under which it's acting and give its rules to itself, not obey popes and monarchs, which is childish, but to be mature. To be mature is to be autonomous. So now the highest thing, the meaningful difference, remember, was heroes and slaves, was saints and sinners. For us, not quite us anymore, but because we're postmodernish. But for up to recently, the highest thing would have been either to be mature or immature. I mean, Freud thinks in terms of maturity, for instance. That's that's what you want to be. Not a saint, not a hero. You want to be a mature person who's lucid about their desires and their actions and takes responsibility for them because they've chosen the principles on which they act. And the things are there to be ordered and controlled by us. Oh, by the way, the things from the Christian world were there to be deciphered because they were full of meaning, because they were the creatures. They were, God made them, and they were, and therefore they could all be interpreted. The things aren't around anymore to be interpreted, nor admired like in Homer. Things are around to be ordered and controlled now. Again, what we'll get back to this. I keep saying now, because we're still sort of subjects and objects, and we still are sort of in the control business. And we're just passing, Heidegger would say, and a lot of people now would say, from one understanding of being to another, where we've got this, whatever it is, the only name people have for it is postmodern. But I don't want to go into the details. We'll stick to the modern. So, for the time being. And Heidegger didn't have any glimmer that there was anything beyond the modern when he wrote The Origin of the Work of Art. He only understood that there was something beyond subjects and objects, of sort of, when he read Nietzsche. So now I should stop for a minute. I mean, by now somebody might have something to say. I don't want you all to be just hypnotized. Yeah, Liz.
I don't quite understand why the recognition of multiple truths of being, that is, multiple styles, should undermine the possibility of a single understanding of being.
It doesn't. I misspoke. I mean, I remember the moment when I did, but I thought I would go back to fix it. No, it doesn't. I don't think Heidegger ever needs to repudiate this. There's a lot of puzzlement of just how much he does repudiate being in time in some way, and he didn't finish it. But that was the authenticity, existentialist part of being in time. I don't think he ever goes back on the idea that there is a way of being of equipment and a way of being of stuff and a way of being of people. It's just that he thinks that what's interesting now is the particular style of the way of being of each of these things. And that's what we should be studying, because then we can understand who we are and how we got this way and what to do about it. But you're right. I don't mean to say that Heidegger repudiated this picture. Yeah?
Is it maybe not so much that, of course, the equipment changes, but isn't it because the equipment changes and the skill to use the equipment change because of perception?
Yes. Well, perception.
Isn't there, there's something in within all four of them, there's something changes that creates a change in the graph.
Well, maybe, but if it is, it's not perception, according to Heidegger, and I will agree with him. It's what I would call coping. I mean, it's our way of dealing with things. That's his language. We deal with ourselves. We deal with equipment. We even deal with this stuff by staring at it and noting its properties. Scientists deal with this kind of stuff. And so, yes, there's always got to be this basic, some way of dealing with things, and that changes. And then that's what it is for the style to change. And perception is going to be derivative from that for Heidegger, because perception is going to depend on what you're going to pay attention to. It's going to depend on the style. And the style is going to be this more basic sort of physicality. Let me read you something. I was going to read it anyway at some point. I'll read it now. The person who has such a good feel for this, that's how I knew he was really a crypto-Heideggerian, is Bourdieu. And I'm going to quote one thing from Pierre Bourdieu, is a famous French sociologist. If you haven't heard of him, he'll be very unhappy. Because he's sort of running for main intellectual in France these days. Now that Derrida's sort of passé and Foucault is dead, Bourdieu is probably the smartest and most interesting French intellectual. He's at the Collège de France. And he doesn't write very well, so I will read slowly. Principles embodied are, and he doesn't really mean principles, let's say style, because you'll see why, embodied, are placed beyond the grasp of consciousness and cannot be touched by voluntary, deliberate transformation, cannot even be made explicit. Nothing seems more ineffable, more incommunicable, more inimitable, and more precious than the values given body, made body, by the transubstantiation achieved by the hidden persuasion of an implicit pedagogy, that's the Japanese example, capable of instilling a whole cosmology, an ethics, a metaphysics, a political philosophy, through injunctions as insignificant as stand up straight and don't hold your knife in your left hand. Now, that's close, I want to say, and even the injunctions don't get to the bottom of it. Just the way the father stands, the son will imitate, and the way the mother stands, the daughter will imitate. And if the father stands in a proud, aggressive way, and the mother stands in a meek, submissive way, the gender roles are already being laid out, and what it is to be a man and what it is to be a woman in that culture are being laid out. And what people will perceive, to come back to your point, is going to already be influenced by this much more pervasive, embodied pedagogy that Bourdieu is so interested in, which Heidegger never talks about in those terms. Body never shows up in Heidegger. He doesn't know how to deal with the body. He says in a parenthesis in Being and Time that the body is a whole other problem and he's not going to deal with it. But he's quite clear that whatever he's talking about isn't in people's minds. And so it's sort of in limbo, these practices that he's talking about. These ways of dealing, to use his language. And it's also the mood. I haven't talked about that. I should say a word. Cultures have, whole cultures have moods, Heidegger thinks. The Greeks, we'll hear a lot about their mood of wonder in what we're going to read. And the Christians had their own kind of pious mood. And we've got, what have we got? Well, Heidegger thinks by the time we get to us, we've got a mood of erschrecken. How do you translate that for us?
Terror.
Frightened mood. So you want to put that in. It's not all just coping skills. It's also mood. But, of course, mood is something, too, you learn. Babies learn to have either Japanese moods or American moods. Different cultures accentuate different moods. And all of this is together in one. It may be a word for it Heidegger uses sometimes when he isn't talking about the understanding of being, is that it's a basic familiarity. That we each one of us get this familiarity with the world as it's laid out. He already has familiarity here. There he says our familiarity is the way we find ourselves around about find our way about in the world. And here there would be different familiarity for each of these different styles. Okay, anybody else want to say anything? I mean, Liz is right to have asked that. There must be other things I've missed.
As far as when
missed.
He talks about Greece and the Christian culture, when he refers to them, does he just think that they had one kind of predominant characteristic, or does he think that there was any kind of change in flux that went on?
Good. He generally goes for the one predominant thing. Because that's what interests him. He claims that there is one understanding of being. But he's clear that there are what I call marginal practices. There are leftovers from other understandings of being, and there are ways of behaving that have never been taken up into the understanding of being. Foucault is good on that, that the Greeks had this what we would call sexuality, but they didn't have a notion of sexuality. They had a notion of aphrodisia, things that felt good, and that sort of fell outside of the law and outside of the general understanding of what it is to be a human being, and it got pulled in by the Christians and called flesh and became a big deal. But different experiences can be just marginal and outside. And that's going to turn out to be very important. I make a lot more out of it than Heidegger does. It's going to turn out to have a lot to do with the question we're going to talk about next week, which is how understandings of being change. But if they were completely monolithic, I think one wouldn't. Well, there would be two puzzles. We wouldn't know how the people inside of them could ever understand they had them at all. Well, let's scratch that. That's misleading. Let me think a minute. No, what we wouldn't be able to understand is how, given that we're in ours, for instance, we could ever understand the Greek one at all. If there weren't marginal practices left from the Greeks and the Christians in the modern world, and we wouldn't be able to understand them. And part of Heidegger's phenomenology when he's doing this kind of thing is to go and find practices that are still around, that which he can use to give you a feel for what it would have been to have a Physis culture, Physis being his name for this whooshing up kind of culture. Maybe athletics, maybe the Olympic, the Olympics are still moments when sort of heroes whoosh up. And so you can go back and and try to, what would it be like if that was the most, the kind of paradigm case of being in a culture, and then you can try to reconstruct it. That's a very good question. But if you think that it's more pluralistic than that, then you're outside of Heidegger. Heidegger thinks there is one dominant one, and the rest are all marginal. Yeah?
So is Heidegger then working in some sort of Platonic paradigm, or Platonic tradition?
No, because the two reasons, no, at least. I mean, one, I don't think there's any place for the marginal story in Plato. I mean, there would just be, nor even for the historical story. See, Plato's got this idea that there are these ideas, they're eternal, they're accessible to any human being who knows how to go get them, which is a complicated training procedure. But it's Heidegger's very, very far from Plato. In fact, he thinks that Plato, well, I'll give you a little bit of a story here, because there's a little bit of extra time. Okay, what Heidegger thinks is that the world, and I better give you a bunch of synonyms now. There are more than I've given. He'll just mention the world in The Origin of the Work of Art, all right. But he also calls it the open, and he also calls it a clearing, like a clearing in a field, which is an opening in which things show up. Now, I've been telling you that the world, or the open, or the clearing, or the understanding of being, or the truth of being, gives you this space in which things can show up. Now, in a certain way then, it creates the fact that anything shows up as anything. And it's the ground of the intelligibility of anything, remember. It's that on the basis of which anything is understood. But it's hidden. And now I have to tell you about that. And because it's hidden, I want to jump ahead of the story so I won't forget. People will tend to overlook it. And philosophers, starting with Plato, will misdescribe the way it works in such a way as to pass over and cover up the clearing. But let me do a move first. This stuff all withdraws, Heidegger said. Let's talk about that for a minute. What does that mean? Well, that means that the style, as he says in the Basic Questions of Philosophy book that you're going to read, that it's the style is like the illumination in the room. That is, we see everything in terms of this illumination. It's the background that enables us to see things, but itself, it withdraws, in Heidegger language, it has to be invisible for us to be able to see anything at all. If you could see the illumination in the room as sort of something, then you couldn't see anything else. I mean, like filling the room with enough smoke and dust that you could see the illumination very clearly in a sense. You wouldn't see the chairs. So one way to think about what Plato did is to say, first he says that. He says that there's got to be a kind of an illumination in terms of which everything is intelligible. And that's, Heidegger would agree, that's the understanding of being. And then those of you who know Plato know that he made the next move, and moreover, there is an entity, the good, which is the source of that illumination, in terms of which we see everything, and in terms of which there is anything. How many know the myth of the cave and the sun story? Okay, you all good. That's good. I mean, Heidegger goes along with half of the sun story. There is something which makes everything that is visible, visible. And that's the light, and that's a metaphor for something that makes everything that's intelligible, intelligible. And that's the background practices and the mood and the style. But then Plato makes, and that's hidden, like the illumination in the room. So when Plato starts to ask himself, well, how is it that everything gets to be intelligible? And how is it that it all gets created, or grows, as it's in the myth of the sun story? And the answer is, well, there must be a super being that is the ground of the intelligibility and in some way, later in Christianity more clearly, creates all this, everything that is. Understand what you think is that Heidegger thinks that all philosophers from Plato on have sensed that there is something more than things, and that there has to be some way to account for the fact that there is intelligibility and things are showing up as something. But then they have their candidate of some super thing. The good in Plato, the unmoved mover in Aristotle, the substance in Spinoza, the transcendental unity of apperception in Kant, that Heidegger calls that ontotheology. That is, they find a beingest being, in Heidegger taught, in which then they explain everything. And that's what Plato is the first to do. And it's a natural trap to fall into. Not inevitable, because if it were inevitable, Heidegger wouldn't be able to get out of it. If the clearing were so invisible, if this were so invisible that you just couldn't ever get any sense of it, that it was there, you saw that there was everything and it was intelligible, you'd be driven to some kind of philosophy story. But it isn't like that. But it is the case that the way the clearing is hard to get any grip on leads philosophers to give the wrong account of how things can make sense to people and why there is anything at all. And Plato is the first. That's what you started. Let me go on and then you can talk again. Because I sort of skipped over trying to do too many things at once. There are lots of ways that the world is invisible. It's invisible like the illumination in the room that has to withdraw so it can do its job. It's also the style is invisible because it's pretty much like the color of the illumination in the room. That is, it's so pervasive that you don't see any counterclass. I mean, if you're socialized into the middle of the Middle Ages, it's so obvious that everything is creatures of God to be interpreted and so forth. The idea of even a counterclass doesn't make any, you can't think of anything that isn't, so you don't see it. It's so pervasive, it's like the water to the fish. That's the second way it's invisible. And then the Bourdieu way of its being invisible is that it's too embodied. That is, it's there not in your beliefs, not in the principles you've got, not in your language. It's already there before you've got a mind and beliefs and principles and language. It's in the way you stand and the way you move and the way you what you pay attention to and so forth. And in that way, it's invisible. In Heidegger jargon, in From Being and Time, the understanding of being is the nearest and therefore the furthest away. And that's the third one. It's so much a part of us, so close to us, so just us, that we can't stand back and see it. And for that reason, I'm going to let people talk in just a minute. So it's been missed by philosophers for 2,000 years, Heidegger says. Now, you want to follow up on your question?
Yeah, so is what Heidegger doing, is he building an economy of strategy against representation?
And how? But it's not really his business in this course. Being in Time, Division 1, is all against the view that there is, that we are primarily minds with representations, and by way of those representations we encounter a world. And the way he does it is what I'm telling you, is this kind of Deweyan, Wittgensteinian, pragmatist emphasis on our dealing and coping and not on our thinking. And thinking becomes derivative. There is a place for thinking. If the equipment breaks, you have to think about it. If you want to look at the stuff and look at its properties and make laws about it and do science, you can do that. But all of this thinking, and even using any particular piece of equipment, takes place already in a world that's familiar to us and has these general coping skills built into it. And that's what he wants, and in that sense he wants to not deny representation, but relativize representation. Give it a minor role in the story of how there is us and worlds. Now, somebody over here looked like they were about to say something. Yeah.
I know this is counter to maybe the later Heidegger, but does he ever point out that there's a danger in giving a preeminence to language, or that language, because language has a tendency to almost categorize things.
And
does
how?
Does that obscure our meaning of being by any chance?
Well, that's a funny question. I mean, it's got two answers that sort of oppose each other, I guess. Heidegger doesn't pay any attention to language. For a long time. In early Heidegger, in Being and Time, he thinks that first there is equipment, and then we name some of the equipmental relations, but language is derivative, and that what's basic is the equipment structure. And then he writes in the margin of Being and Time of his copy, no, language is not derivative, it's the very structure of the clearing. And then he realizes that if this is the other side of it, if we didn't categorize things, to put it your way, which we'll do for the moment, we wouldn't be able to see anything at all. But far from thinking that stands in the way, you know, of seeing things as they really are, he thinks that is the way things really are. I mean, if you got rid of the categories, there'd be just nothing there. It would be like the worldview of an oyster. And therefore, it's thanks to language that things show up as anything. And then we'll read, language gets promoted to a very special place in, if not creating the styles, at least in preserving them and in bringing about new ones and so forth. And we'll talk about that. You want to say something?
In relation to the Japanese deity and with Bordeaux using the word embody, and you know, with Heidegger, we don't want to say subject, and we want to avoid this train of thinking. Does he avoid locating where these styles are? Are they being in the world? Is it the interrelations? Where do we find these things?
That's good to think about it. It sounds too individualistic. It's like Merleau-Ponty. It's to say the locus of the style is the embodied skills of each individual. And yet, that's sort of right. But why doesn't Heidegger want to say it? Because it's because what seems to him basic is the shared equipment and coping that each child, so to speak, comes into, which isn't so much, I'm trying to figure this out for myself. Certainly the equipment and stuff isn't in any particular body, but how about the style? Well, the style is in all the bodies, all right, but it's, no, you certainly don't want to say unconscious.
I know, that's why I want to, but
okay.
I know that.
Okay. And the reason you can't is, of course, that because it's not the sort of thing that can be conscious. I mean, all that goes into being a woman or feminine or masculine in our culture, for instance, is something that's not all that something clear, but we're just not, it's unconscious. It's a whole way of moving and coping and so forth, and it's not in the business of being conscious or unconscious. That's why I want to follow Bourdieu. It's in his language, habitus.
You just said the word.
What?
Style of, rather than
a
style. You said of.
Yeah.
It's of instead of and.
Well, yeah, but I mean, but how am I going to make good on that? Let me think. You got any idea? I mean, I want to say some. You got to get the feel that I don't know how to put it very well, but I'll think about it before next time. That he thinks of it as the world of the mood. And the equipment and the style is all there for each individual to come into and be raised into. And the bottom line is that it's all there. And to somehow try to ground it in, a bunch of individuals, all of whom have these styles in them, somehow their styles mesh, and that makes this bigger style. And then it just is nothing he thinks would ever work, that kind of individualism. That where the style and the mood is so spread around that it won't make it, here's the best I can say, it won't make it more intelligible to try to derive it from each, because if you really tried to think it through, how your style and your body and my style and my body and her style and her body adds up to the style of the culture, you wouldn't be able to work it out any more than you can work out the idea that the way we know that there are other minds is that I know that you know that I know that you know stuff. That doesn't work out. Now, let me think if I can say anything more about it.
You said that Heidegger says it. Did you say that Heidegger doesn't call it the body?
He doesn't care about the body, and he doesn't ground it in individuals. I've been doing that because it's easier to grasp. What happens, and I'll try to say more about it next time if I can, is that he just drops talking about individuals, drops talking about Dasein at all, and ends up talking about the style of the culture as the ultimate sort of level of intelligibility and not trying to derive it nor explain it in terms of any being. It would be a kind of subjectivism, a kind of modernity, really, to try to ground the world or the open or the clearing in the habits and styles of the individuals. He wants to say the ultimate is the world with its equipment, its buildings, its mood, its style. At best I can do. But I want to make sure I finished. Okay, now I want to add one more question and we're ready to stop. Philosophers have got it wrong for 2,000 years. They've tried to ground this in something else. And we just saw how tempting it is for us moderns to ground it in us. But he's grounding it in God. First tried to ground it in God. Then Descartes and Kant and so forth tried to ground it in us. Heidegger is going along with somebody like Hegel in that respect. It's not groundable in any individual, any kind of entity. So, but now the question becomes, I want to leave you with this, but how could a culture see its own cultural style if it's invisible like the illumination, if it's pervasive like the water to the fish, and if it's in every detail of the culture, never mind the individual bodies, but it's all over in all tiny details of the micro practices, as Foucault might say. How does the culture ever get to see its own style? That's one question we got to deal with. And the second question is, how does a style ever get started and get maintained? Well, that's what the origin of the work of art is about, both of those things. And that's why we're going to read it next. And now time is up. But any last minute question? Otherwise, yeah.
So in terms of style and movie, so where does Heidegger's discourse exist as far as these two things are concerned?
He says that he's describing the phenomena. Just like you describe the mood at a party, for instance. Let me try that. You don't describe the mood at the party by describing each person's mood. There's a mood at the party, Heidegger says, and this is a nice example. I'm going to stop with this, but I want to tell you. There's a mood at the party. Anybody coming into the party gets that mood. But the mood isn't going to be explainable in terms of the moods of each of the people at the party. And the culture is a big version of that. His discourse is a method for describing the overall style or mood that every individual will come into and get.
But it's affected by the mood and style that...
Yes, and the discourse is itself within it. So how is it ever going to get out of it? That's a good question. I'll get there. We will deal with that. Okay.
Your time.
Recorder, please tell me.